blessing, but you know, sometimes it can be a hard thing to stand up and say something that may be conceived as controversial and offensive even to some people. And you need to be a little strong to maintain the message that has to be preached, because it's so tempting to water it out and to say it in a soft way, not to offend people. But therefore, I have chosen just to say it just like it is. I have much respect for those categories of people that I'm covering, like Americans and Catholics and all other kinds of people that are described in the prophecies. I have much respect for them, and I'm not there headhunting for people, individual people as such. We are talking about the systems, the great systems in the warfare between good and evil in these last days. And I think it will be helpful. So this is the first thing I will do. I will write here the seven world empires. And this can be a nice reference for what we studied yesterday and for what we will study today and tomorrow. So let us start with a word of prayer. Dear Father in heaven, we come before you in the name of Jesus, and we are so grateful, we are so thankful to you for your blessings and for the Holy Spirit who will enlighten us into the truth. Help us and guide us, dear Lord, because in ourselves we can do nothing and we can understand nothing. It is only through your power, through the power of your Spirit, that we can understand these things. Help us to see Jesus Christ in his powerful position as our Savior. Help us to see him as the victorious one in the warfare between good and evil. For we pray for these things in the name of Jesus. Amen. You know, in Daniel and Revelation, there are seven world empires that are described as animals. Not eight, not nine, not six, not five, but seven world empires. And these may be of a political nature, of an ideological nature, or a purely religious nature, at least a mixture of religion. So I will mention these seven world powers that started from the time of Daniel and until Jesus' second coming. And all of them have been described as an animal in Daniel or in the book of Revelation, or in both. So these seven world empires, and of course we start with Babylon. We start with Babylon. And what I will just say is, who took over the dominance of the then known world after Babylon? We know from history that that is no other power than Medo-Persia. Okay? Medes and the Persians. Persia. And then we ask the same question. Who came after the Medes and the Persians? According to the histories, the history of the world, according to basic textbooks in historical studies from the ancient world, from the Eastern world, who succeeded Persia? Of course, Greece exceeded Persia. And there is no question about that. And we know the time when the Romans succeeded the Greeks. They were in very close contact with each other, these systems. And there is a transition period between these systems also. Sometimes the change took place in one night. Like when the Persians took over control of Babylon, it happened in one night. And you can read about that one night in Daniel chapter 5. And you can also read in secular historians about that transition. So who conquered the Greeks? Of course, everyone knows that the Romans conquered the Greeks. And the Romans, this empire was an incredibly strong empire, the strongest. And I think the most the most sophisticated world empire ever in the history of man. So from about 200 BC until about 500 AD, that is 700 years, Rome was ruling the world. And at the end of Rome's time of ruling, there were many natural catastrophes, finances were low, and pressure from the northern borders of immigrants coming from Germany and Scandinavia. All these together made the Roman Empire to collapse completely. And we mentioned yesterday the last Roman emperor in the western part of the Roman Empire was this Romulus Augustulus, a young chap from ruling the Roman world, but being attacked by the barbarians. I think it was the heralds who made sure that he fell and was annihilated completely. So the barbarians took over from 476. And many historians, they say 476 is the transition point between, or this is the point, AD, when the Roman Empire is collapsing. But you know, the collapse of the Roman Empire took several hundred years. And when you read the best story ever written on this issue by Edward Gibbon, The Decline and Fall of the Roman Empire, he will say it took hundreds of years from Rome, from when you see the first signs of corruption and the fall, until you see the actual fall. Whereas from Babylon to the Persians, it took one day. But from Rome to the next power, or from Greece to Rome, it also took 100 years or something like that. So these transitions can take place very rapidly, or they can take hundreds of years. So the Romans ruled until this time. So the Roman Empire is gone. The Roman Empire continued in the eastern part, making Constantinople the capital. And we call this the Byzantine Empire. But the Byzantine Empire is very different from the Roman Empire. So the classical Roman Empire collapsed about 500 after Christ. And who took over the seat in Rome where the emperors had been sitting? Who took over all these glories that the population put on the emperor? Who was the next to sit in the emperor's chair? Of course, it was no other than the Pope of the Roman Catholic Church. So he took on he maintained the Romanness in that world into the Middle Ages. So that actually Rome is still ruling the world, but no, Rome is ruling the world through the Church. And this took place, and therefore we say the Roman Church is the next. Roman Church. And you know, you can never understand European history if you don't understand the Roman Church. Because European history is almost like the Roman Church. Everyone in Europe, except for the eccentric heretics and other people who were persecuted, few people here and there, everyone was a Roman Catholic in Europe from 500 AD until 1500 AD, basically. If you tried to challenge the Roman Catholic Church, being an inhabitant of a Roman Catholic country in Europe, you would die. Nobody could challenge it, especially not the doctrines of the Roman Catholic Church. So this is the fact that for more than 1,000 years, the Roman Catholic Church ruled, in the beginning only spiritually, but more and more civilly or politically, they ruled over people. And the high point of this rulership of the Roman Catholic Church, I would say, was around 1200 AD. Around 1200 AD, you have popes like Innocent III, very, very powerful pope. He was ruling over Europe, and for some times the Catholic Church owned more than half of all the fields of Europe. And with 20,000 monasteries scattered all over Europe as milking cows, money sent to Rome, of course, it was a very powerful institution. And everyone in Europe had to be obedient to this system. And the most incredible thing is that these things were written in the Bible hundreds of years before they happened, before the rise of this enormously powerful Roman church, 1,000 years before it succeeded to power, this church in Europe. It was described by Daniel the prophet as the little horn in Daniel chapter 7. And we read it yesterday. So the Roman church actually ruled for about 1,200 years until the next great superpower came and actually killed this Roman Catholic Church system. And there was such a killing in history, and the killing took place actually in 1798, and it was executed by the French Revolution. And the French Revolution is a superpower in many ways. It's an ideological movement, and it scattered all over Europe, and it declared that God is dead. God is dead, so they carried the woman of wisdom, or whatever they call it, the goddess of wisdom, into the streets of Paris. Some say she was a prostitute, and she was carried in there, and people were screaming, "God is dead, long live the goddess of reason." And at that time, you know, a little after that time, this great philosopher, I don't know if I'm calling him a great philosopher, but Friedrich Nietzsche, you've heard about Friedrich Nietzsche. We are going into a time of atheism, a time when God is no longer to be mentioned. It's a scientific age. Faith has no longer bearing on us. And then Friedrich Nietzsche is born, the most famous atheist of all times, only perhaps succeeded by Richard Dawkins these days, but very, very famous atheist. And somebody told me about the graffiti somewhere, and it said with big letters, it said, "God is dead, Friedrich Nietzsche," with small letters. And then underneath it said, "Nietzsche is dead, God," with small letters. So this is the case. We are now entering a new age in man's history. We are going through a paradigm shift, what these wise men call it. There is a shift as we are speaking in year 2016. There is a shift going on from this thinking of materialism, of worldliness, and ignoring God and the supernatural. There is a shift, and the shift is to the next superpower. You know who influenced the French Revolution influenced, by the way, around the world? Anyone from the old Soviet regime here? You remember the old Soviet regime? What was the inspiration for the Soviet regime? It was the French Revolution, of course. And the same with China. You know, like 50 years ago, about 50 years ago, more than half of the entire population of the world lived in a communist or a materialistic, atheistic country in this world. Soviet Empire, big, hundreds of millions of people. You have China and certain countries in Africa and certain countries elsewhere. So it made up about half of the population of the world. And for years and years, USA and the Soviet Empire competed to be the best empire in the world. So 40 years ago, we didn't know really who is going to be the victorious of these two fighting forces. Will it be America or will it be USSR? And everyone knows today who is the conqueror. And who won the fight between Soviet and USA? Of course, USA won. Everyone knows this. So the next power is the USA.
Here we have one animal, two animal, three, four, five, six, seven.
These are the seven animals of the apocalyptic world. No more, no less. These are empires. These are united forces. They are uniting millions of people together into these movements here. And when we study now Revelation chapter 12, it will be a good reminder for us to look at this system here. And I can give you the dates if you're interested. The transition was 539 BC here. And from Persia to Greece, it was about 330 BC. And you know Alexander the Great was the master of that transition. And here we have 165 approximately. And here we have 476, but we could also say 538 AD, because that is a significant year. And then we have the Roman Church, the fall, the collapse of the Roman Church in 1798. And also the collapse around that time for the Inquisition. Also the collapse of the old ancient laws established by Justinian, about 500, the Justinian Code. So very significant, 1798, not the coincidence. Here we have 1260 years between these two. Okay, and the next, the French Revolution, I will say about year 2000 AD. And you remember with me what happened with Solidarity in Poland. You remember how the Berlin Wall collapsed completely. You remember the name of the Russian president, Gorbachev, who helped this transition. And now USA is ruling the world. USA is ruling, there is no question. And Trump, do you think he will give away this if he becomes the president? Which we no one of us hope he is becoming the next president. I assume I know your mindset so well that nobody will like him to be the president, next president. But if he becomes the next president, he is never giving in. He is going to continue to rule the world, even more tight, I believe. So, we are now making a transition here. And the transition is to the world of apocalyptic. Revelation chapter 12. And I will be reading Revelation chapter 12, and I will maybe note a few things here, because Revelation 12 is a very interesting, is interesting chapter. If we see here now Revelation chapter 2 and 3, we call these the seven churches. Churches, okay? Revelation 2 and 3. And then we have Revelation chapter 6 until 7. And this we call the seven seals. Are you with me?
Yes.
And then we have the seven trumpets. Trumpets. And this is from Revelation 8 until Revelation chapter 11. And then we have something called the woman and the dragon. Woman plus dragon. And this is Revelation chapter 12. And then we have the beast, the two beasts. Beast from sea, beasts from sea and earth. And this is Revelation chapter 13. So here we have a structure in the book of Revelation that we should pay attention to. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. And the structure is the following here. If we start here. And you see the seven churches is dividing church history into seven parts. Okay?
just in the same manner that Daniel 2 is dividing history into four animals, and also the fifth power, the little horn, or the fifth power in Daniel 2 with the feet as iron and clay. So here we see the first church is Ephesus. Ephesus. And the next one is, what is it called? It's called Sardis. No, it's called Smyrna. Smyrna. And after Smyrna, we have Pergamon. Pergamon. And then after Pergamon, we have Thyatira. Thyatira, then Sardis. And Philadelphia. Philadelphia. And the last one, I don't remember. Where was the last one? Yeah, Laodicea. That's right, that's right. I wonder, Laodicea. I wonder why we call churches Ephesus and Smyrna, and I've seen Bethel, and we have Philadelphia, but nobody is calling them Laodicea. I wonder why. Now, you see, this is dividing church history. This, the seven churches prophecy in Revelation chapter 2 and 3 is dividing church history into these seven churches. Each church representing a period in church history. And actually, I'd like to suggest for you the dates, because these can be a little controversial these days. But I start here with the crucifixion of Jesus, and then about 100, and then Smyrna, 313, and Pergamum to Thyatira, I say 538, and Thyatira to Sardis, I say 1517, and Sardis to Philadelphia, I say 1755, and the last one, 1844. Of course, we could discuss a long time if these years are relevant, but these are the standard years from the historicist point of view, if you are with me. So the interesting thing here is that the first seal and the second seal and the third seal and the fourth seal are parallel with these churches. That makes it so much easier to understand the book of Revelation. Because these are really parallel. And when you come later on, they are really parallel here also, I will suggest. But when we come to the trumpets, the parallel is very close, the first few trumpets. But when we come here, things are getting a little more difficult with the fifth and the sixth trumpet. Okay, then things are becoming a little confusing. But here we have seven churches, seven seals, seven trumpets. Just as in Daniel, we have four metals and we have four animals. Can you see a parallel there? There is an attempt to build a structure, a logical structure. And if you cannot see that there must be a structure in Revelation around number seven, I'm sorry, but you are pretty blind. Because it is like this. There are seven churches, seven seals, seven trumpets, and it means something. The most logical parallel is Daniel. Four metals, four animals. And likewise here, first church is equal to the first seal and the first trumpet. This will help us to understand the book of Revelation. Because when we now come to the woman in chapter 12, which we are going to study now, we will see that there is the same pattern, but we have no help with numbers this time. We must figure out from our logic and from previous chapters we have studied that, of course, the woman and the dragon, we must start around the time of Christ. Because the very important principle is to start when the prophet is living and the time the prophet is living in. So in regard to John, who is the author here, he was living in the first century and he was living in the eastern part of the Roman Empire. So that is the natural starting point for unfolding the prophecy. So this is very logical, and we know that the end of the prophecy, and the prophecy will go through history in what we call a historicist manner, or continuous manner. And it will reach a highlight here at the end of time. At the end of time.
So this will, this is this prophecy, and the same is the case with Revelation chapter 13. So here we have five PP visions. You remember yesterday PP vision? PP vision.
That is a vision that goes from the time of the prophet until the very end when Jesus is coming back next second time.
This is a PP vision. So the revelation, the woman in Revelation and the dragon, this is a very typical PP vision. Starting at the time of Christ, prophet, continuing progressively and expandingly toward the end, reaching the climax at Jesus' second coming. Every single vision here has this pattern. Starting at the time of Christ, at the time of the prophet, ending at the time of Jesus' second coming. Every single one. Every single of the four visions we have in the book of Daniel. Daniel chapter 2, Daniel chapter 7, Daniel chapter 8, and Daniel chapter 11. All of them start at the time of Daniel, and they reach a climax at Jesus' second coming. There is a pattern here, isn't it? There is a very logical pattern. And it is aesthetically also. So it's worth admiring. And therefore, from these patterns, from this, we can actually deduce that the woman in Revelation chapter 12 starts with the time of the prophet that ends with Jesus' second coming. Okay, so now we are ready, eventually. Or maybe we should have a break because, you know, I have no understanding of your suffering, physiologically speaking. But let's go to Revelation chapter 12 and let's get over with that one. And it is really about God's people through history, Revelation chapter 12. And it is a very fascinating story. And I will be reading, and you have a sheet of paper before you, so you can follow as we progress into this remarkable chapter in the Bible. Now a great sign appeared in heaven. I like to see it as a big IMAX scene in heaven. You know, you have billions of angels and other inhabitants there. They watch something big on a screen there. And what do they watch? They watch an image from the earth. And a woman clothed with the sun, with the moon under her feet, and on her head a garland of 12 stars. This verse is so compressed with symbols that we need actually to sort it out here a little bit. We have so many symbols here, and I'll see if I can. Can I take away here? Here we take away. Okay, we have several symbols here. Woman. Okay, a woman is a symbol. A woman is different from a man. I've been claiming that very severely lately, that the woman is different from a man. And there is no question about it. God chose to use a woman as a symbol of something very significant here. He couldn't use a man because a man wouldn't fit. There is a difference between man and woman. A good argument here in that discussion. But okay, woman is described here. And she has clothes. She's wearing clothes. Okay, she was clothed with the sun. Another powerful symbol, with the sun. And with the moon under her feet. And then we have another one, moon. And we even have the word feet. And on her head, a garland of 12 stars. We have the word head. And we have this garland, which is a symbol also. But I'm thinking especially about 12. And I'm thinking about stars. Can you see in this little verse, we have 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8 powerful symbols in one little verse. And what do we do to solve this mystery? Because we can't progress into the chapter if we don't know what the first verse means. So therefore, let's spend a little time unpacking these. Thank you, we have an American among us. Oh, we have two Americans. I think. One, two, three. Yeah, four. Okay, the number is rising here. Good, good. So I'm not. I feel on shaky ground sometimes. I would, of course, chosen to speak in Norwegian if I had a normal, you know, invitation and to have this kind of meeting. Of course, you know, I'm not crazy. I would prefer to speak in Norwegian, but we are forced to speak in English because of our good friends over there in Lithuania, and you understand that. So bear over with me a little bit more. But woman, you are quite clever in these things. You know that a woman in the Old Testament means, symbolizes. Be careful when you say it now, because if you say just a church, it is correct, but you need to put a minus or a plus before, because there are two women in the book of Revelation. There is one prostitute woman, and there is one pure woman, a virgin woman. And that is a very different between these two women. Where do you meet the prostitute woman? What chapter? Chapter?
17.
17, yeah, that's right. Chapter 17, there you meet the unworthy woman. So a woman is really God's, is really a religious people. Religious people. We think of it as the church. Either the pure church or the fallen church. And what about clothes? Would any one of you dare to come out here tonight without clothes? I wouldn't dare to stand here without clothes. There is a reason we are wearing clothes. And two very major reasons for wearing clothes is protection from the cold, and also to hide something that we feel by nature shameful of. And also it's the custom of the country. But in religious terms, in apocalyptic terms, what does clothes mean? It means either righteousness or unrighteousness. Yeah. Either you are clothed with the Christ, with the righteousness of Christ, or you are clothed with your own dirty, sinful righteousness. These are the two options in the Bible. If you are naked like the Laodiceans, they are in the absolute worst condition, because they don't even realize that they are naked. So these clothes means righteousness, either righteousness or non-righteousness or sinfulness. So this woman here, do you get the impression that she is a good woman or a bad woman? Is she on the good side or on the bad side? She is on the good side, definitely. So therefore, we can give her, we can be more concrete, we can say it's God's people. It's God's church. We can also say that it is right, the righteousness of Christ, the clothes that she is wearing. And we can go on to say that the Son, if you go to with me just to explain how this is going on. In Psalm 84, and there, if you go with me to, I think it is verse 12, you will see that it speaks about 84 verse 11 in my English Bible, but I think it is verse 12 in the Norwegian. 84:12. Let's see what sun means. Because in nature, sun means what is giving life to this planet, what is maintaining life. Sun is also giving light so that we can see. And sun has so many wonderful attributes to benefit the human race. So it's something very positive with the sun. But the sun can also be very negative. It can kill, because the power from the sun is able to kill, if that should be the case. Psalm 84, are you with me here? Psalm 84, and then we go to... I'm too slow here with my Bible.
11.
Verse 12. 84:12. There it says?
In English.
11 in English.
11 in English, yeah. For the Lord God is a sun and a shield. The Lord will give grace and glory. No good thing will he withhold from those who walk uprightly.
So the sun is really God, another symbol of God. But you know that Satan is called the morning star in one place. Lucifer has something to do with sun also. So there is a plus and there is a minus. And then what about closest righteousness? Righteousness. And what about moon? Moon is here understood in relationship to the sun. You see, in the day or in the night, we can see the sun, we can see God through the moon. So, because the sun is shining its light on the moon, and the light is reflected to us here in the world. So the moon can be either Jesus Christ or the Bible. Therefore, the woman stands on very firm platform. He stands on the moon. Can you see that in the text? She stands on the moon. So really, it means something, the most firm we have, and that is the Bible, and that is Jesus Christ. Because through the Bible, we can see God, we can see Jesus Christ. So the Bible is a very good definition for what moons mean, in my point of view, Bible. But Jesus Christ could also be the case here. You know what Jesus Christ is called in Revelation chapter 19? There is a special name. Jesus has many names in the Bible. But what is he called in Revelation chapter 19? His name is the Word of God. So Jesus is really the Word of God. So when we read the Bible, we partake of the Son of God. We partake of Jesus Christ. And we become, of course, more like him. Let's go to the 12 here. 12, the number 12 is, there are four numbers in Daniel and Revelation, in the Bible actually. Four numbers that are relevant and that have a symbolic meaning. And these four numbers are number 4, number 7, number 10, and number 12. 4, 7, 10, and 12. I would like to be challenged on this, because these are the basic numbers, and all the numbers you encounter when you study the book of Revelation, they derive from one of these four numbers. So when you read about 144,000, what number does it derive from? This 12, because 144,000 is 12 times 12,000. So you see, number 4 means all the directions, south, east, west, north. And it's a geographical area, it's a symbol of number 4. Number 7 is the perfect number. And number 10 is the number of test. 10 commandments, testing our character. The 10 plagues in Egypt, testing Pharaoh. The 10 days of Daniel and his friends in Babylon was testing their testing. Test us in 10 days, Daniel even saying. And if you go to Revelation chapter 2, verse 10, it speaks about God's people being sent into prison to be tested for 10 days. So number 10 is the number of test. And what about number 12? That is the number of God's people, of course. That's the number of God's people. So 12 is number of God's people. And stars. You know, today we even have stars. We say it Hollywood star. You know what it means when it says Hollywood star? I think we all are enlightened about that, being bombarded by the media constantly. And are there stars in the Olympic Games? Yes, there are stars. And a star in the book of Revelation means a powerful individual. It basically means an angel. It can be an evil angel or it can be a good angel. But it can also be very powerful people in the world. They can also be stars. Because a star has this attribute that something follows the star. And the star is leading out other people. This is the meaning. So therefore, from this, we can now summarize what really Revelation chapter 12, verse 1 is saying. And I'll say it, try to say it in modern Norwegian, or not modern English, in a way that it is being understood. So let's read.
chapter 12, verse 1. We are not going through each verse in like manner, but we gave this first verse as an example. Okay? Here it says, "Now a great sign appeared in heaven." Let's imagine that we are in an enormous image hall, IMAX hall in heaven, seeing a screen, 3D screen, the most fancy you can imagine. And what do you see on that screen in heaven? You see God's people, a woman. God's people was righteous because God's people was clothed with the sun. God's people had the righteousness of God. It had really it has the righteousness of God. With the moon under her feet, and God's people is planted on solid ground on the word of God, which is really Jesus Christ. And on her head, the garland of 12 stars. And also, she has 12 patriarchs in the Old Testament to lead her. And in the New Testament, she has the 12 disciples, eventually becoming the 12 apostles, as the stars, as the leaders for the Christian church. So you see, God has a church. He has a movement 2,000 years ago when this apocalyptic story is starting. From the very starting point, God has arranged everything. So it's a good start. Even before Jesus was born, God had a church. And in the Old Testament, the church was the Jewish people. Today, the church consists of people from all nations. There is no favor in the eyes of God when it comes to the different nations in this world. Although many of us may agree that Norwegians are more loved than others, but God loves everyone. I know there are many Christians believing that God loves the Israelites, the Jews, more than he loves the rest of us. And this is a discussion for a later occasion, of course, but a very controversial thing. So here we see God's people at 2,000 years ago, ready to receive a gift from heaven. Verse 12, verse 2. Then being with child. So God's people is about to give birth. And this is very significant, because in Matthew chapter 24, there is a verse saying that the special natural catastrophes and challenges God's people is meeting with toward the end of the world, the Bible says, but this is only the beginning of the birth pangs. Have you read that text in Matthew chapter 4? So when something is being born, it is a signification in the Bible that the Messiah is being revealed to us, either first time or second time. So here we have the birth of Messiah. Then being with child, she cried out in labor. It was a hard thing for God's people there under the Roman oak and under Pharisees and Bible teachers who did not know the narrow way, who had compromised and who had accepted Greek philosophy and believed in immortality of the soul and the rest of it. It was hard to be God's people 2,000 years ago. Then being with child, she cried out in labor and in pain to give birth. Anyone here having given birth ever in their lives? Was it a very comfortable experience? You just enjoyed the whole process? No, it was painful, wasn't it? For some it was not painful. There are even ladies, they give birth, they think they go to the VC room and plop, it's done. You know, there are examples of this. But it is a painful, generally speaking, it is a painful experience. Very painful experience. And something that we men, we pray God that we are not women. But when a woman have given birth to a little child, is she smiling? Oh, she is very happy. And she has forgotten all the turmoil, even if it happened 5 minutes ago. And this is just the nature of giving birth to children in this world. And God made it that way. I don't know why he did it, but he made it that way. So something to learn from. And the Bible is using the same type of imagery to describe the first coming of Jesus Christ to this world. Verse 3. And another sign appeared in heaven. Behold, a great fiery red dragon, having seven heads and ten horns and seven diadems on his heads. This is Satan, according to verse 9. So let the Bible explain itself. And the best explanation is when the explanation comes from the Bible, from the same chapter, which is the case here. Verse 9, so the great dragon was cast out, that serpent of old, called the devil and Satan, who deceives the whole world. He was cast to the earth, and his angels were cast out with him. So Satan is this power in verse 3, a great fiery red dragon. Here you have colors. The colors mean something in the book of Revelation and in the rest of the Bible. What about the color red? It means basically two things. It means the blood of Jesus Christ, but it also means persecution and sin. It can mean persecution and sin, but it can also mean the blood of Jesus Christ. In this sense, Satan is a red monster. That means he's a sinful monster. He's a persecuting monster. He's a terrible monster. Behold, a great fiery red dragon having seven heads. And you know these seven heads? These are Babylon, Persia, Greece, Roman Church, French Revolution, USA. These are the seven heads. And you can read about the seven heads in Revelation chapter 17. So, he had seven heads and ten horns. And the ten horns refer to Europe, because there is one power lacking here, and that is the power of Europe. And why is not Europe mentioned as a superpower? It is because Europe was never united. Europe was always divided. From the time of the collapse of the Roman Empire, they called it the Holy Roman Empire, but it was not holy, it was not Roman, and it was not an empire. It was split up into many, many groups of nations and peoples. It was never really united. The only thing that united Europe was really the Roman Church. As it is today, the only common denominator in Europe today, you know what that is? It's not the economy, because one country has euro, another country has kronor. It is not language, because there are different languages. It's not even culture, because we have different. Can you compare the Greeks and the Norwegians? Do we have a common culture? I would say we don't have common culture. We are from another part of the world, so to speak. But there is one thing that brings us all together in Europe, and that is Christianity. That's the only thing that binds us together. And of course, the future powers, when they awake, and they have awakened already, they will play on this. They will play enormously on this. So you see, as we progress here, so that is wonderful. And there we have this unclean prostitute woman, and here we have this red dragon, terrible monster, seven heads, but how can something evil use the number seven, which is the perfect number? Because this is an evil power using number seven. We just concluded that number seven is a perfect number. Because we can say it's perfect in evil. It's perfect in evil. Therefore, the number seven is used here. We go to verse 4. Because this dragon has a tail. And you know, a tail means something in the Bible. If I pass by here, and I'm a cat, for instance, and I pass by you, and with my tail touches you just a little bit. You think the cat has a message to that lady? The cat has a message to that lady. He's using the tail, this cat, to convey a message. Maybe the message is, I find you very interesting. Maybe we could play afterwards or something like that. You never know what the cat will say. But it's going to say something. The tail means something. And in this narrative, the tail means something. What does the tail mean? Because Satan has a tail. And how does he use it? He drew a third of the stars of heaven and drew them to the earth. And the dragon stood before the woman who was ready to give birth to devour her child as soon as it was born. So he used the tail to deceive one third of the angels in heaven. He used his tail? let's have the Bible to explain what tails means. Because in Isaiah chapter 9, verse 14 and verse 15, you have an interesting explanation. Isaiah chapter 9, Isaiah chapter 9, and verse 14 and verse 15. There we will have an explanation, because we believe in sola scriptura. We believe that the Bible will interpret itself, explain itself. So therefore, we see here in chapter 9 and verse 14 and verse 15. Therefore, the Lord will cut off head and tail from Israel. Okay, this is a punishment to the Israelites. He will cut off head and tail, palm branch and bulrush in one day. The elder and honorable, he is the head, the prophet who teaches lies, he is the tail. Can you see what the tail is? A prophet who teaches lies. That is the tail. So how was Satan able to deceive one third of the intelligent angels in heaven? How was he able to do that? By lying about God, of course. By lying. He was claiming that God was unfair and the rules were too strict and God was unfair because all the blessings were given on Jesus and not on Lucifer. He deserved more and blah, 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 all these things. So this was how Satan deceived, using his tail, using lies. And is he still using lies? Mm-hmm. Oh yeah, he is a master of lies. And this book is counteracting the lies because this is the book of truth. And politics and the world and academia and all these things in this current world, they are full of lies. There are truths also in these things. But the only truth that we know of, this is this Bible. It is 100% truth. We can trust it. So this was the message of Luther. This was the message of Wesley. This was the message of Miller. This is the message for our times. The Bible, you can trust, it's the Word of God. There might be some minute mistakes because of translation or because of some manuscripts that we have misunderstood the meaning of and so forth. But these are of a very, very minute nature. This Word you can trust. Either you can trust it or you cannot trust it. And Christianity has to make their decision. Will they trust this Word? Or will they reject this word? Because you can't just cut out chapters and pages and say, this is not trustworthy, this is trustworthy, I trust this, but this is a lie, this should not be there. You can't treat the Bible like that. Either it is true or it is not true. Am I the only one in Mjøndalen who thinks like this? You agree with me? Yeah. Either the Bible is true or it is not true. Yeah. And there are complexities, of course there are complexities, there have always been complexities. When Jesus lived, there was also complexities in the Old Testament. The reason there are complexities in the Bible is a proof that God has inspired it. Because if we understood everything in the Bible, it would mean that there is no Almighty God who has inspired it. It's just a human product. But God's thoughts are higher than our thoughts. Therefore, the Bible is also higher than our thoughts. Let's continue. Verse 5. And she bore a male child. And you know who this is. First, in verse 4. The dragon stood before the woman. Who is the dragon in this story? It's Satan, first and foremost. But Satan is using systems here. He's using these seven heads to proclaim his message, to persecute, to get his way in this world. And which of these did he use here? He used the Romans here. Obviously, he used the Romans. And we could spend lots of time explaining this, but we will not do that. But it is obvious that when Jesus was born, it was the Roman Empire that ruled. And who was the representative of the Roman Empire in the Levant, which they call it, or Palestine, or Israel? Herod the Great was the representative of Rome. So he was Rome's longer arm in the Palestines at that time when Jesus was born. So Did he try to kill Jesus? Most definitely, yeah. And this is exactly what the verse is saying. And the dragon stood before the woman who was ready to give birth to devour her child as soon as it was born. But Jesus was delivered by holy angels and by God. Verse 5, and she bore a male child. And this male child is Jesus Christ, who was to rule all nations with a rod of iron. And her child was caught up to God and to his throne. Was Jesus later caught up to God, to his throne? Yes, it makes perfect sense that this is about Jesus Christ and his birth in Palestine 2,000 years ago. Verse 6, then the woman fled into the wilderness, where she has a place prepared by God, that they should feed her there 1,260 days. Can you see now in this verse, we have moved a little bit forward here. Not very much. And then there is these words about the 1,260 days. Because this is a rescue place for the church that is being persecuted. Satan, he hates three things. He hates God, Jesus. He hates the Bible and the law of God. And he hates God's people. These are the three things Satan hates. And he is making all the efforts he can to destroy these three things. But you know, when Jesus went up to heaven, there was no Jesus to persecute. And the word of God is firmly laid there with letters and manuscripts, so he could not really destroy the word of God either. So who is left? God's people. And he is persecuting God's people. And this is the story how he is persecuting God's people and when it happens. So here we come to a break. We come to a break in the story. From verse 7 until verse 12, we have a parenthesis. We are projected into another time, another story. And this is a feature of apocalyptic that we haven't really seen often before. It's kind of complicated because we are so used to the easy going from Daniel 2 and Daniel 7. And you know, you just use your brain and you read carefully and no problem. But here, we have some challenges. And the closer we get to the end of the book of Revelation, the more difficult it gets. Especially the structure. This is a special feature of a structure in Revelation chapter 12. But a war broke out, and we are actually projected back to the time before mankind was created by God. So it could be millions of years ago, actually, in terms of human chronology. It could also be 10, 15,000 years ago. We don't know that. It doesn't say, because a day in heaven is different from a day on earth. But there was a war in heaven. And this was not a war with military weapons. It was a war of arguments, which we have today also, a war of arguments. This is the final war in this world will be a war of arguments. Is God truthful when he speaks in his word? Or is he untrustful? There was broke war out in heaven. And heaven is big. Now they've just discovered that there are not 100 billion galaxies in the universe. There are 200 billion galaxies. They doubled the number. And many scientists, they believe that there are multiple other universes. And it is incredible. They've also, beyond doubt today, proven that there are more than several hundred million solar systems in our own galaxy. It's a big, big universe. We are just a dot. We are like a sand grain in Sahara with all the other suns and planets in the universe. And war broke out in heaven. Michael, and you know what Michael means? It means the one who is equal to God. Michael and his angels fought against the dragon and his angels fought. So Jesus and Satan is here competing in war with each other. It's a verbal war. But they did not prevail, nor was a place found for them in heaven any longer. And this is the dragon. The dragon was cast out from heaven, Satan. So the great dragon was cast out, that serpent of all, that means he could no longer be in heaven. God wanted to cleanse heaven from sin, from unrighteousness. Because if God would let Satan and his friends be in heaven, it would influence the whole universe as a virus, and we would have to live with sin for the rest of eternity. But God took action. Praise the Lord. He took action. So he concentrated the problem, and he sent this army of evil angels down to this world before it had even been created biological life in this world. And I believe Satan and his angels were witnesses to the creation of Adam and Eve, the Garden of Eden, and all the wonderful things in this world. This planet may have been just an empty planet for hundreds, thousands of years like Mars. But when God came here to create a world, he created biological life for the first time. And this was less than 10,000 years ago, according to the Bible. So the great dragon was cast out, that serpent of old called the devil and Satan, who deceives the whole world. He was cast to the earth, and his angels were cast out with him. Then I heard a loud voice saying in heaven, now salvation and strength and the kingdom of our God and the power of his Christ have come, for the accuser of our brethren, who accused them before our God day and night, has been cast down. So there was great happiness in the Bible, of course. They lost, they got rid of their worst psychopath ever. And he was now in another place. He was in this world. Therefore I say, you and I will live in the worst possible place in the universe. If I could choose what planet to live on what, or what solar system to live in this universe, the least one I would choose would be the Earth here. Although I'm very happy for Henrietta, as you can understand. I would hate to miss her though, but this is the worst possible place to live for human beings. Where there is atmosphere, where there is civilization in this universe, and that is many places, there are many places, this is the worst place of all these places. Because all the hordes of evil angels, they are here. They are outside the windows. I don't know if God has allowed them to come in here and disturb us, but they are here, and we have to live with them every day. And of course, people in heaven were very happy for this exclusion of this group of evil forces. And they overcame him. God's people overcame Satan by the blood of the Lamb and by the word of their testimony, and they did not love their lives to the death. So they loved God more than they loved almost their own lives. They were willing to give up their lives for the love of God. This is wonderful. They confessed with their testimony, and their deepest confession was when they gave their life for Jesus in persecution. Therefore, rejoice heavens and you who dwell in them, woe to the inhabitants of the earth and the sea, for the devil has come down to you, having great wrath, because he knows that he has a short time. Therefore rejoice. What does it say? Therefore rejoice, O heavens, and you who dwell in them. He doesn't speak to the earth and the people in the earth, but he speaks to the inhabited universe. Therefore rejoice, O heavens, and you who dwell in them. But woe to the earth, because Satan has come down to you, and he knows that he has just a short time left. How does he know that he has just a short time? Probably he is a very eager student of the book of Daniel and the book of Revelation. And I know that he has read a book called The Great Controversy. And if there is any book you need to read, if you are a visitor here tonight, it is the book The Great Controversy. And I have one friend here in this hall that I promised to give that book before I leave for Denmark. So that's a wonderful book. That is such a good book. That changed my life. 30 years ago, my life was changed after reading that book. Wonderful book. And it, even hundreds of years before it happens, this book has told about it. So we can trust this book. So Satan knows that he has a short time only because he knows the prophecies. Therefore he knows there is very little time left. Verse 30. Now when the dragon saw that he had been cast to the earth. You know when he saw that? He saw that when Jesus hung on the cross. He saw that when he tried to stop Jesus from going up on the cross to die for us. He knew that that very moment when Jesus died for humanity, his case is lost. And Jesus was of course tempted not to go up to the cross. So therefore he put all his forces, all his influences to that very moment when they were beating Jesus before his crucifixion. And Satan was hoping that Jesus would scream out, "Stop, stop, stop, I can't handle it." Because then Satan's future life would have been certain if Jesus did not go up on the cross. But he went up on the cross. He did not deny the reason why he came to this world. And therefore Jesus Christ is our only hope. Our only hope. Because if we go to ourselves, there is no rescue. We are sinful beings who need salvation through Jesus Christ. And he is our only hope, of course. So now when the dragon saw that he had been cast to the earth, he persecuted the woman who gave birth to the male child. But the woman was given two wings of a great eagle, that she might fly into the wilderness to her place where she is nourished for a time and times and half a time from the presence of the serpent. So here we are again reminded about this 1260 years period. And it is described as 42 months. In the Bible, it's described as 3.5 years. Okay. And it's described as a half time, times and half a time. And 1260 days. And you know how many times this period, this exact period has been mentioned in Daniel and Revelation? Exactly seven times. You know the other time period, another time period in the book of Revelation and Daniel that has been repeated more than one time? Any time period repeated more than one time? No. So not only is it repeating the 1260 days more than one, seven times. Does that mean that it is a significant number? A significant period? Very significant period. And we better find out when it starts and when it ends. Because this is part and parcel of the exposition or exposing of the Antichrist power. So, but the woman was given two wings of a great eagle that she might fly into the wilderness. And this is the place of protection. Wilderness is the opposite of city. It's a place where there are not many people. You can escape all the dangers of the city. Where she is nourished for a time, times and half a time, that is 3.5 years, which is the same as 42 months, which is the same as 1260 days, which is the same as 1260 years. Verse 15, so the serpent spewed water out of his mouth. The serpent is Satan, of course, and the powers Satan is working through. And in this case, there can be no other power than the Roman church that he's working through, because they persecuted. And you can read church history books, secular history books also, and you find out that thousands and thousands, yeah, millions were killed because of faith in Jesus Christ, because of refusing to listen to the Pope. So the serpent spewed water. Water, what is that? That is people. So armies of people were going after the Waldensians, after the different groups of religious people who escaped the Roman teachings. So the serpent spewed water out of his mouth like a flood. That means a long military row of people after the woman, that she might cause her to be carried away by the flood. But the woman maintained her faith in Christ, and the woman was helped by a certain power here. Verse 16, but the earth helped the woman. Can you see how we have moved through history here? We have moved through history. We have moved now beyond the 1260 years, or we are in that period. And at this time especially, there is a new force coming on the scene called the earth. It is called, but the earth helped the woman. And what is the earth? It must be in contrast to the sea in chapter 13, verse 1. Because then you see a power coming up from the sea. And here, just a few verses before, you have the earth. There is a heavy contrast there between earth and sea. And when we think about an animal coming up from the sea, we're thinking of a power coming up in warfare environments, so to speak. Lots of people. Also, coming up from the sea means that you come up from the sea of people. Lots of people. But when a power is coming up from the earth, it means that it is not coming up among lots of people, but coming up in more calm circumstances. And around this time, at the end of the 1260 days, years, when lots of people in Europe were still persecuted by the Roman power, where did they find rescue? Where could they escape? Of course, they escaped to the United States of America. So United States of America became a haven, became an oasis in the world for all the persecuted people. And we have the first boat that went over from Europe of persecuted people who wanted to practice their religion according to their conscience. But they were not allowed to do so in England and other places. What was the name of the first boat carrying these refugees, so to speak, over from Europe to America? I think it was called Mayflower. You've heard it when I said it. Mayflower. And there came a stream of persecuted people from Norway, from Sweden, from Denmark, Germany, all over, to go over to the United States to be able to worship God according to our conscience. Because in America was the first nation in the world to separate church and state. Church and politics. It was the first nation in the world to also maintain that there is a God, maintaining that there is a Judeo-Christian value that we need to maintain. This was the first country in the world. It was an example for the rest of the world. Therefore, God blessed America immensely because it had this perfect political statement that we need to separate church and state. And today in the Middle East, you know, the problem can be solved easily. It can be solved easily in Syria, it can be solved easily in Iraq, in Afghanistan, in Saudi Arabia, in all these Islamic countries. You know how you solve the problem? You separate church and religion, or church and state. Religion and state. And then you have no problem, because the problem there is if you change religion, you are being killed. But if you separate church and state, religion have no power to kill another because of his or her opinion. And this was the case in America. Wonderful, wonderful concept. And therefore, America has been blessed, although it has done many bad things. Don't misunderstand me. It can be an evil society, but it has been blessed by the Lord. And it has been a place where people can come and find rest for their souls, the persecuted of this world. America is a mixture of all peoples of the world. I've lived there for several years, and I admire America. I love America. But there are some dangers in the horizon, because there will be a shift. And you know what I'm thinking about, some of you. But the earth helped the woman. And the earth opened its mouth and swallowed up the flood which the dragon had spewed out of his mouth. So the earth, that is United States of America, eliminated the threat of persecution by making this fantastic, fantastic righteous law separating church and state. Separate. And we in Norway, we've just realized that this is the most smart thing to do. I think they did it last year or this year. But they are still in the process. I read today in the newspaper, it cost 4.7 million kroner to maintain the Norwegian state church the next year. That's quite a bit of money. That is 1,000 kroner from every Norwegian. And another church society in Norway, another free church, will get only 600 kroner per member. I don't know how they defend this, but there is much unfairness when you have a state church. so much unfairness. Just because somebody interprets the Bible another way than others, they will be favored by the state. It is so anachronistic. It is like from the deepest darkness of the Middle Ages. And still we are maintaining this system in Norway. It's unbelievable. Absolutely unbelievable. Okay, and the dragon was enraged with the woman. So Satan is angry, and this is the end of the world. We have come now to the Laodicean time, and it's the end of the world. Satan is angry with God's people, with the woman. And he went to make war with the rest of her offspring. He's leaving where he is, has a comfortable time. He's going over somewhere else, and he is now making war with the rest of her offspring. That is the reminding ones of God's people. The last generation of God's people. Who keep, and here we have the, who they are. Who keep the commandments of God and have the testimony of Jesus Christ. So who are God's people in the world today? Those who have faith in the word of God. Who will not dilute the Ten Commandments. And who will be faithful to Jesus Christ. This is God's people today. And God's people will grow because people from Babylon will come to God's people. And there will be two groups. I will almost call them two ecumenical groups. Somebody doesn't like when I say this. But I think these are two ecumenical groups. Because in the big Babylonian group, you have people from all nations, from all churches. This is the big Babylonian group. And then you have the little group of those who keep the commandments of God and have the faith of Jesus. And these are godly people from all different denominations. There are Catholics there, there are Methodists there, there are Adventists there, there are Baptists, there are even Jehovah's Witnesses there. You have them from all religions also, converted to Jesus and to the Word of God, exemplified in the Ten Commandments. So may God help us. And there is one little verse, and then we'll take a break. I hope we can go over the next. The very verse is very, very interesting. In chapter 13, verse 1, there is a statement saying, "Then I stood on the sand of the sea." Then I stood on the sand of the sea. It could also be in the Greek, "And he stood on the sand of the sea." And that makes a very interesting parallel with Daniel 11. The last verses there in Daniel 11. Because after, when the persecution of God's people will take place in this world, Satan himself is showing, displaying his very physical body. And he's telling the world, "I'm Jesus Christ," and the world will worship him. Except for God's people, those who keep the commandments of God and have the faith of Jesus. And this is very serious time we are going into. This will be the greatest of all deceptions. When Satan himself in physical body is coming here to the world and have the clothes of Jesus Christ and the smile and the charm of Jesus Christ and telling the world, "This is Jesus." And the world will lay down flat before him and worship him. And you know, to be among God's people, those who keep the commandments of God and have the faith of Jesus, to raise up and say, "No, he's not Jesus, he's Satan." You need to be brave to do that, you think? So if you are not brave today, you and I will have a hard time when that time comes. I tell you. So today is the time to practice being brave. But in an orderly manner, of course, not be a wild anarchist. But to be brave. God is looking for brave people these days. May God bless us. And where we will be digging into the book of Revelation, chapter 13. And we just went through chapter 12. And not very detailed, but I think you got the narrative from the beginning to the end. And there is a clear point that is being conveyed from that chapter. And that is, God has a people and Satan hates his people and he tries to eliminate his people. But God will rescue his people and his people will vindicate his character, which is the law of God. So that in the last days, before Jesus comes back, there will be a people of God who respects the Bible entirely and who also has accepted the Ten Commandments as the rule of law, as the character of Christ and God, and who shows very deep faith and faithfulness to Jesus Christ. There will be a people like that. And these people will vindicate the character of God. In the same manner that Jesus vindicated the character of God when he came to this world for 30 years plus to manifest the love of God to us. So when Jesus went up on the cross, totally innocent of any harmful doing, he was pure and clean. And yet when he was there on the cross, he vindicated the love of God. He showed the whole universe that God is love. And in the end of the world, and it could be perceivable even for some of us sitting here in this hall, there will be a people vindicating the love of God and the character of God. And I can see that there is much potential in God's people. In America, there is a movement these days. Hundreds of medical professionals, they come together and they rent big stadiums, big halls. Hundreds of them, sometimes more than 1,000 health professionals, medical doctors, dentists, physical therapists, they come together. And you know, they advertise in the big newspapers of that particular city they come to. They say, we give free treatment to all the poor people of this town. Have you heard about it?
Yeah.
I cry when I see these things. This is the love of God, period. Wouldn't you agree? And you see the poor people who have no insurance over in America, and they've had toothaches for years and years, and they've lived with it. When they go to bed, they have this toothache. When they wake up, they have this toothache. They come into this group of health professionals, these Christians, and he is treated from this terrible thing. Of course, this is the best way to win people to the church, through love. Yeah. But we have such a good time here in Norway. We live in an almost socialistic country where health is free and everything is free. Can we do something that touch people's heart? To give them a desire to come to be part of the church? There must be something we also can do. And if this will fail, then we have the Word of God. Because the Word of God has the power in itself to convert people, to bring them back to harmony with the will of God. And especially the message for the last days. Because then you can really push people and say there will be a mark of the beast, of Satan, of Antichrist, and there will be a mark of God. What mark do you want to follow? What mark do you want to have on your hand? And if you explain these things properly to them, these people, they will have to make a decision either for Christ or against Christ. So I am convinced that before Jesus comes back second time, the world will be forced to make a decision. And this is through the miracles of Satan. This is through the love that God's people is showing to the world. There are many avenues for that decision. But mainly it will be the preaching of the three angels' messages. That will really put the world on the spot and force people to make a decision for Jesus Christ or against Jesus Christ. We are now going to Revelation chapter 13. And this is a heavy chapter, I tell you. It's a heavy chapter. And it is really a parody of Christ. This chapter is a parody of Christ. Shall we pray to the Lord before we enter this study? Dear Father in heaven, thank you so much for your word. Thank you for your spirit. Thank you for your son who died for us. Be with us as we now will dig into a very complicated but very important chapter in the Bible. Help us to see you, Jesus, in this chapter. For we pray in your name, in the name of Jesus. Amen. Okay, chapter 13 in the book of Revelation. And I claim that this chapter is a description of Satan's parody of Jesus Christ. So, really, the powers you are reading about in this chapter is really trying to, I don't know if they willingly try to imitate God's word, but there are very significant similarities between God's work and Satan's work. Because if Satan is going to deceive the world, will he come into Mjøndalen Church a Sabbath morning and with two horns here, two horns and Dracula teeth and blood pouring down there, and you know this terrible face, and he will come here, I'm now ready to give the church the mark of the beast, you just stretch your arm out and I'll come and stamp your hands as we go along. Is that his way of coming? No. He is taking off his shoes and he's walking like this between the pews. And he's whispering things into our ears. And we have no wonder that he is the one who is whispering these things to us. He is coming like a deceptive angel, an angel of light, the Bible says. And if we go with me to 2 Corinthians chapter 11, there is an interesting statement on satanic methodology in deception. And if you go with me to 2 Corinthians chapter 11 and verse 13. And this is satanic methodology in deceiving God's people. What is his method? And you'll see it clearly in Revelation chapter 13. There it says in verse 13, 2 Corinthians chapter 11, "For such are false apostles, deceitful workers, transforming themselves into apostles of Christ. And no wonder, for Satan himself transforms himself into an angel of light. Therefore, it is no great thing if his ministers also transform themselves into ministers of righteousness, whose end will be according to their works." So Satan, he has his ministers, and God has his ministers. And there is actually a fight between one theology and another theology. And we, as poor people in this world, we have to choose. What theology shall I listen to? What theology shall I reject? Because in the world of religion, there is so much deception. There is deception among the conservatives. There is deception among the liberals. We are surrounded by deceptions. So the only safe thing we can do is to go to the Bible, the Word of God, and read it for ourselves and pray to God and keep friendship with good, solid Christians who have proven their Christianity by their good deeds. That's the only way we can do it. So Revelation chapter 13 is the classic example in the Bible what Satan will do to deceive the whole world. Here is his program for deception. And we read on here, Then I stood on the sand of the sea. Yeah, that was the previous chapter, I believe, belonged to. And I saw, this is John, and I saw a beast rising up out of the sea, having seven heads and 10 horns, and on his horns 10 crowns, and on his heads a blasphemous name. So here we have a beast rising up from the sea, and just to simplify these things, you know, the Father,
the Son and the Holy Spirit. This is what we call the Holy Trinity. Although some people, I myself do not like the word Trinity. Although I believe in the concept of the Trinity, but I don't believe in the word Trinity, because there are so many associations with that word. It was used very cynically in church history to persecute people. So, and this word was invented by Roman Catholics at some point in history. Why shall we adore this word? Although I believe in the concept of this word, but I don't believe in the word itself. Ellen G. White, for instance, she never uses the word Trinity in her writings, never. But she uses similar words like triune God and three powers in heaven and this kind of language, but never the word Trinity. But here, for the sake of example, I will use these three, because this is the Holy Trinity for this, only for this particular lesson. And then we have the counterpart, and that is dragon, and then sea beast, and land beast. Okay? And these correspond with each other, because here we have the Holy Trinity, and here we have the unholy Trinity. And there is a very clear play on this concept in Revelation chapter 13. There is actually no question about this. There is a very, very clear connection between the three powers of heaven and the three devilish powers of earth in this chapter. And I have had a personal Bible study with a Roman Catholic who is now a priest in the Roman Catholic Church, where we went through the texts in this chapter, and he had to agree that, oh, technically speaking, of course, it is the unholy Trinity, and it's imitating God, and but when it came to the conclusion, he was not willing to listen and to accept the truth as it was presented. Unfortunate for him. So, this beast was rising out of the sea. That is a new world power coming out of the sea. And we see that it had seven heads. And these seven heads is a representation of the seven world powers I wrote on the blackboard just recently. And ten horns are Europe. So this is using the powers and the influence from many forces in order to itself become a masterpiece of evil. I will call it a masterpiece of evil. And it has the composition of Babylon, it has the composition, it has features of Greece, and it has of Persia, of Roman Empire. It has features of all the evil powers in world history. And the essence of an evil empire. And on his heads a blasphemous name. So not even only evil, it was also blasphemous. It placed itself in the place of God like the Roman emperor, some of them had done. We know about Caligula, we know about Nero, and others who actually called themselves God. And we know also from ancient history, from some of the old empires, they viewed almost themselves as God. And they were blasphemous. So here we have this power coming up from the sea, this new power. And I will suggest that this power must be the Roman papacy. And why do I suggest this? Because when you compare all the details of this animal, of this system in chapter 13 with the little horn in Daniel 7, you will find that it is identically the same power. Identically the same power. And it's very, very interesting if we conclude that the little horn in Daniel 7 must be
papal Rome, then the first beast coming up from the sea here must be the papal power. There is no other way to explain it, because the similarities are so compelling that the conclusion must be this is the same power. Therefore, this must be the Roman papacy. Okay, here it coming up from the sea, and then verse 2, now the beast which I saw was like a leopard. That reminds us of the animals in Daniel 7. Leopard was Greece, and his feet were like the feet of a bear. The bear was Medo-Persia, and his mouth like the mouth of a lion was Babylon. So he is seeing backwards in reverse, and the last of these three animals that came up was actually the leopard. So therefore he sees the leopard first, and then he sees the next, and then the last one is the lion, because lion is the first one to come up from the sea. And the dragon gave him his power, his throne, and great authority. Can you see the dragon, which is Satan, which is the Roman Empire, we have concluded from chapter 12. If that is the Roman Empire and Satan, the Roman Empire is giving its authority to this new beast coming up from the sea. And this new beast is the papal Rome. So the Roman Empire is giving its authority to the Roman papacy. Can that be verified from historical sources? Yes, indeed it can. We have letters from Justinian to the Pope in the 530s, explaining to the world that the Pope is the ruler of all the world. He is the ruler of all the Christians in the world. We have these documents. And there are many documents explaining how the Roman Empire was ushering in the new age of the Roman papacy. And books have been written about this. And it is a fact that in the 500s, the papacy came up and received power to be exercised for the next 1,000+ years. So here we have the story once more told, but from another perspective. The dragon gave him his power, his throne, and great authority. And then I saw one of his heads as if it had been mortally wounded. So after this authority was granted for 1260 years, what happened at the end of the 1260 years? It lost its power. It lost its life even. And it was mortally wounded. And this was after 1260 years. I saw one of his heads as if it had been mortally wounded. And his deadly wound was healed. So after this deadly wound, it was healed gradually in a way. And all the world marveled and followed the beast. So at the end of time, there will be a new enthusiasm, a religious enthusiasm to exalt the papacy, to follow the Pope, and to let the Pope be the leader of this world. This is what the text is saying here. If we take with us what we have learned from Daniel, what we have learned from Revelation chapter 12. Verse 4, so they worshipped the dragon who gave authority to the beast, and they worshipped the beast saying, who is like the beast? This is the same they say about the name Michael, because the meaning of Michael is who is like God. Who is like God? Here we have the same challenge. Who is like the beast? So this system is raising up and claiming to be the supreme system of this world. You find it in the writings. In the writings of the popes in history, they have immense big claims about their own power, and they have been placed here as the vicar of Christ. Can you imagine? There is one vicar of Christ. There is one who is vicariously stepping in for Jesus Christ in this world. Not many people, but one person. And his name is Pope Francis. It's quite a claim to say, only I in the world, I am the vicar of Christ. Isn't that quite heavy? As Protestant Christians, can we accept that? No, it's false teaching, it's heresy. This is not true Christianity, says things like that. We have one. We have Jesus Christ. We don't want the Pope in his place. We want Jesus Christ. And the Pope and Jesus is not on holiday. He is not hospitalized. Jesus Christ is alive. And he is here today among us through his Spirit. And the Pope has no right to say, I am the vicar of Christ. It is blasphemy. Why can't I say, oh no, you are not the vicar of Christ. I am the vicar of Christ. Everyone can say, I'm the vicar of Christ. But he has this monopoly on this. And the world is bowing down and saying, it's okay. And we must protest. We cannot accept this. This is a gross heresy. Gross heresy. There is not a word in the Bible that can prove it. So, and he gave a mouth, verse 5, and he was given a mouth speaking great things and blasphemies. That's just what I have explained. You see, Martin Luther, he was very angry with the Pope for that he called himself the vicar of Christ. He hated it, and he was fighting against it all his life. And we don't seem to come up with a little beep, not even a little beep. So there is a big job for some of us to do. And you can bless God. You can be blessed if you are not called by God to stand up before a congregation to speak about these unpopular things. You must just thank the Lord that you don't need to do this. Because it's not a happy work. It's not something that you want to do by your own will. Unless you are compelled by the word and by God to do it. So when you go to bed tonight, thank the Lord and say to him, God, thank you that I don't need to stand up before a congregation to speak about these things. Wouldn't you agree with me? Yeah. So therefore, I need support from you with your prayers. Because it's hard to stand up and somebody has to do it. If nobody does it, we completely fail to what God has called us to in this world. We completely fail. We are no better than the Jehovah's Witnesses and the Mormons. No better. If we fail this very important work. Oh, okay. And it was, verse 7. And it was granted to him to make war with the saints and to overcome them. And authority was given him over every tribe, tongue, and nation. So this is going to be a very powerful force in these last days. And all who dwell on the earth will worship him. Pay attention to it. All who dwell on the earth will worship him. Everyone in this world will respect the papacy, will respect the demands of the Pope one day. We have not explained in what special thing that will be focused on. But on one issue, we will show obedience to the Pope, unless we are in that group, that small group called in the Bible, those who keep the commandments of God and have the faith of Jesus. All the Ten Commandments, including the Sabbath commandment. And all who dwell on the earth will worship him, whose names have not been written in the book of life of the Lamb slain from the foundation of the world. So there is a little tiny group. They will not worship the devil or the Antichrist, the papal pope. We will not worship him. So there is, and this is the only place in the whole chapter where you can see Jesus Christ. Verse 8. The rest of it is so dark. The whole chapter is so dark. And it is so devilish and diabolic. And it is so uncomfortable to read through it. But here we have Christ. Because it says, unless all will worship him, whose names have not been written in the book of life of the Lamb slain from the foundation of the world. So Jesus was slain from the foundation of the world. His crucifixion was foreseen by the Lord. And by God. And I know that God would never create human beings unless he had a plan to rescue them. That was in his mind before he created Adam and Eve. God knew that I must have a rescue plan. So the rescue plan, the plan to save those who will be saved, that was established before man was created. So this was probably the first creation of God in this sense. He created, and therefore wisdom was created first, as it says in Proverbs chapter 8, I believe. Wisdom was the first that was created, even before man. So this was this gospel. Okay, verse 9, if anyone has an ear, let him hear. He who leads into captivity shall go into captivity. He who kills with the sword must be killed with the sword. Here is the patience and the faith of the saints. Okay, so this is the first part, and we will focus on this now. And let's have a look at Jesus Christ. Jesus Christ, he was born, you know when he was born? Approximately 4-5 BC. Couldn't you agree with that? Yeah. And he was killed. When was he killed? What year? He was baptized 27? 31, yeah. He was killed 31. So that was the life expansion of Jesus Christ. And you know, he was baptized when he was about... When he was 27, almost 30 years old. Let us say in 27 he was baptized. Okay, 27 he was baptized. And then he was about 30 years. And we have this information from Luke chapter 3. There it says, and this was the 15th year of Tiberius. So if we can figure out the 15th year of Tiberius, we know the year Jesus was baptized. And we also know that that Jesus was 30 years when he was baptized. So therefore, mathematically, this is piece of cake. It means that Jesus must have been born 4 or 5 BC. And this fits extremely well with the prophecies in Daniel chapter 9, as you also know. And this is a confirmation that Daniel 8 and Daniel 9 is the right interpretation that we have provided for years and years and years. Because if this is correct with Daniel 9, then we know also that 1844 must be a correct year. Because if 1844 is not the correct year, then it doesn't fit with Christ either. So these you can double check. And also you must correspond that with this, and of course the 30 years of Jesus and 15th year of Tiberius. But my point here is that Jesus was born here, he was baptized there, so Jesus was baptized in year 27. What happened? He came up from the water when he was baptized, didn't he? He went into the water and he came out of the water. And this is how this beast is described also. Because this beast had a history long time before it was baptized. This beast, this Antichrist beast, was baptized in the 500s. I believe the year for his baptism was 538. 538 after Christ. Then the beast was baptized. It says here, then I stood, verse 1, chapter 13, then I stood on the sand of the sea, and I saw a beast rising up out of the sea. Can you see a sea, a beast rising up out of the sea? But we could also say that this was, in the beginning, it was a slow rising up. But the point here is that this beast started here later on the 1260 years period. For it says in verse 2, and the dragon gave him his power, his throne, and great authority. So for Jesus, how many days did he work as our Messiah with power from God to heal and to do all things? What? It was 3.5 years, yeah. 3.5 years. And what about, it starts, was this in the fall or was it in the springtime? We assume this was in the fall. And this was springtime.
wasn't it?
Yes.
Passover. So from fall 27 to spring 31, you have three and a half years. And 3.5 years is the same as 42 months. And you know how many days are in 1 month, in a Bible month? 30 days in one Bible month. So 30 times 42, how much is that? Okay. So these were the days of Jesus ruling as our Messiah. Are you with me?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah? And Jesus came up from the water, starting to rule this period. And here we have the Antichrist, doing exactly the same as Jesus Christ, coming up from the water and then ruling for 1260 days. Exactly the same. And when we read on here, and when it says in verse 2, and the dragon gave him his power, his throne, and great authority. I'd like to read John chapter 3, verse 35. John chapter 3, verse 35. And what does it say? 3:35, it says, the Father loves the Son and has given all things into his hand. The Father has given all things to his Son. The dragon has given all things to his sea beast. The sea beast works for 1260 days. The Son works for 1260 days. The sea beast is baptized, so to speak, coming up from the water. Jesus Christ is coming up from the water. Okay, we have a good starting point here, because there is more coming. Here it says, verse 3, I saw one of his heads as if it had been mortally wounded. So the sea beast was mortally wounded. After these 1260 days, the sea beast was mortally wounded. Jesus, after the 1260 days, was he mortally wounded?
Yeah.
Yes. And it's very interesting. In the Greek New Testament text, you go to Revelation chapter 5, verse 6. It is identical, practically identical Greek phrase here, but it is used on Jesus Christ this time, not on the Antichrist. If you read with me, chapter 5, verse 6, and I looked, and behold, in the midst of the throne of the four living creatures, and in the midst of the elders, stood a lamb. Okay, this lamb is Jesus Christ. I think you will agree with me there. It's Jesus Christ. As though it had been slain. Can you see that? As though it had been slain. It's the same Greek phrase as you read in chapter 13, verse 3, as if it had been mortally wounded. They are using different words in the Norwegian translation or the English translation, but it is really the same in Greek. And what does it tell us? This verse tells us that there is something identically similar with the sun and with the sea beast. So the Antichrist is not very far from the Christ. That's very, very intriguing. Very, very intriguing. We continue here in Revelation chapter 13. This is for Jesus, and we should have one for Satan also. 5:38 and 17:98. And this was the baptism. And here we have the crucifixion of the beast. And we have the 1260 days of the beast, and the power from above, power from dragon, and here we have power from Father. I think there are quite a bit of parallels here. And his deadly wound was healed. Oh, so Jesus was crucified in 31. Was his deadly wound, was that healed?
Mm-hmm. Oh,
very much indeed. So much that he rose from the dead and he went to heaven. This is healing. This is healing of the wound.
And what about the wound of the Antichrist? Was that healed also? That was also healed. Because it says here that verse 3 in the middle, and his deadly wound was healed. And all the world marveled and followed the beast. Is it true that the world followed Jesus after he was resurrected? Yes, even the whole empire became Christian after Constantine's time. The whole world followed Jesus Christ after his death wound was healed. And it's the same with the Antichrist. Exactly the same with the Antichrist. Verse 4. So they worship the dragon who gave authority to the beast. Is it the same? We worship the Father because he gave authority to the Son? Yes. And they worship the beast, saying, who is like the beast? I wouldn't say who is like this Antichrist. I would say who is like God, and that is Michael. Michael is the one who is like God. There is a question in the name Michael, who is like God? In similar vein, there is a question in this phrase, who is like the beast? So the beast presents himself as the most powerful, in like manner as Jesus presents himself as the most powerful. Verse 4, they worship the dragon who gave birth to the beast, and they worship the beast, saying, who is like the beast? Who is able to make war with him? This is quite a challenge. Can you see it? The beast and the Son, they are here competing, but the beast is trying to imitate the Son, so that I don't know why. I don't know if God intended it like that, or it was coincidence or whatever. This is a more philosophical question, and I'm not the right person to tell this, but there is something strange going on here, that is for sure. And verse 5, and he was given a mouth speaking great things and blasphemies. You know, Jesus was given a great, great mouth. Jesus was saying great things. He was even saying that the Father and I, we are one. If you have seen me, you have seen the Father. If Jesus hadn't said these things, it would be blasphemy. But Jesus was allowed to say these things. He is the standard. He is our creator. He is our God. But the Pope cannot say these things. And although he is given a mouth speaking great things and blasphemies. You know, when the Pope speaks these great things, he speaks things that only Jesus can speak. The Pope speaks things that only Jesus can speak. And therefore the Bible says this is blasphemy. If Jesus had said these things, no problem. But you, Pope, you say them. You are not allowed to say these things. Because you are just a mortal man. You are a sinful creature in this world. You have no authority to say these things. And yet you say these things. Okay. And he was given a mouth speaking great things and blasphemies. And he was given authority to continue for 42 months. 42 months. 1260 days. Exactly the same period Jesus was given here. 42 months. And isn't it remarkable? For every day Jesus received to save mankind, to lift up mankind. For every day he received to lift up mankind, Satan received 1 year to crush mankind and steal their salvation. Isn't that significant? For every day Jesus received to lift up, Satan received 1 year to crush down. So in the last days, when Satan comes there as the guilty part in the drama, and he says, God, why didn't you give me more opportunities? Why didn't you give me more time? What will God say? Perhaps he will say, for every day I gave Jesus my Messiah, for every day I gave him to lift up, I gave you 1 year to turn around, and you are not happy? This is fair game, at least from your point of view. It's not fair from Jesus' point of view, but it's very fair from Satan's point of view. He will have no excuses. And even, you know, when they die at the end of time, and every ungodly person will die in this world, even when they are risen up to life after 1,000 years, these guys, they will not surrender. They have stealed the the seed of hatred toward God. And Satan himself, he sees that Jesus comes back second time and he takes his people with him to heaven. All the others die and the seven plagues. And still Satan will not repent. That means it has been proven. He is unreformable. So therefore he must die. And therefore all the ungodly people must die. It is impossible to reform them. If it was possible to reform them, God loves everyone and he would die to see them converted. Of course. Of course, this is the big thing. So then he opened his mouth in blasphemy. And verse 7, and it was granted to him to make war with the saints and to overcome them. Okay, we have no parallel with Jesus because Jesus is not making war against his saints. He's making war against the ungodly, but not against the saved, not toward the saved. And authority was given him over every type, tongue, and nation. So this will be a very powerful thing in the end. There will be an almost complete powerhouse in this world. And I believe that America and the Vatican will be the two pillars of that power base in the last days. And everyone in the world will submit to this authority. Everyone in the world. And we see it, that this is how it lines up. We can see it already in today. We have been speaking about this for 150 years. And we can see it now clearly before our eyes. Verse 8, and all who dwell on the earth will worship him. In the same manner as all will worship Jesus, so all will worship this terrible beast, whose name have not been written in the book of life of the Lamb slain from the foundation of the world. If anyone has an ear, let him hear, and so forth. He who leads into captivity shall go into captivity. He who kills with the sword must be killed with the sword. He is the patience and the faith of the saints. So this is the story about the first beast, and we will not take time to go into the next beast, but I'd like to share you with you one little, how can we call this, here. You see this? This is a very interesting, because we evaluate on this table, we evaluate the different candidates to be the Antichrist. Because there are many candidates in history who mankind has suggested he is the Antichrist, or he is, or that thing is an Antichrist. And we take all of these, Antiochus, Epiphanes, Nero, Justinian, Karl, this is in Norwegian, of course, Islam, the papacy here, Luther, Napoleon, Hitler, and a future tyrannic dictator. And this is fair, because if we're going to objectively study this and find out who is the Antichrist in history, we must also double-check this with the clear attributes or characteristics of the Antichrist. And these are some of the major characteristics of the Antichrist, as he is presented in the Bible. And to find the right candidate among all these competitors, we have to find out that they must strictly be in accordance with the list of characteristics here. And if you read the Lutheran confession writing, the Concordia book, you'll find a statement there saying that all the characteristics in the Bible for the Antichrist fits perfectly only to the papal Rome. And this has been Protestants' position until 150 years ago. For hundreds and hundreds of years, this was the standard interpretation. So Antiochus Epiphanes, he scores very badly, actually. Only two characteristics fits for him. And if you go to Nero scores very much. He is one of the favorites, of course. And that's the reason that the academicians in Oslo and other places, they vote on Nero as the best Antichrist in history. But still, he lacks some very important stuff. He lacks these 1260 days or years. There is no period with 1260 years or 1260 days that is significant for him. Not at all. And also, he never changed the laws. He did not come from Rome. Rome hadn't appeared. Rome was about to appear when he stood forward. So Nero here, he also has this whole ceremony. I have been very kind with Nero because I wish to give him all the doubt was in his favor. Okay. So if I had analyzed it more carefully, probably several of these would not have been there. The next one is Justinian. He was a devil in flesh, according to contemporary witnesses. And he was a powerful, powerful emperor at the time when Rome was collapsing and the new papal Rome was coming up. He was the main person. He is just as important in church history, I will say, as Constantine the Great. And Constantine has a big name. Therefore, he's also called Justinian the Great. He was a great emperor. And he eliminated all the resistance against the papacy in his empire. He eliminated all resistance to the papacy. And he lifted up the Pope as the ruler, as the ruler for all the Christians. And he told all those who disagreed with Rome, he told them, if you don't leave my empire in 3 months, I'm going to kill you. So all who opposed Rome, all who had another theology than the Roman Catholic Church, they were expelled from the Roman Empire in his days. So he actually prepared for these 1260 years of papacy. He prepared very well, much better than any other emperor could do. So Justinian is a good candidate, but there are so many things lacking in his life that is not according to the characteristics. Charlemagne in English, Karl den Store in Norwegian, he also has some, he had big ambitions. He was the first really ruler or the first emperor of the Holy Roman Empire. And so he's a candidate. And Islam, of course, is also a candidate. But you know, there are very few parallels between the characteristics of Antichrist in the Bible and Islam. Very, very few. I tell you, Islam is very God-fearing. Islam is extremely God-fearing, and they are very scared of blasphemy of any type. If you go to ISIS, you know, these very surrealistic, bizarre monsters in this world, of course, you have something else. But Islam generally is actually much more God-fearing than Christianity these days, I dare to say. I know Muslims, and I've interacted with Muslims. They have enormous respect for God, the creator of the universe. Did you know that? Yeah, enormous respect for it. So, but they cannot be classified the Antichrist. There was a great scholar over in America. His name was Samuel Bakayoko. Have you heard about him? He claimed that Islam was in some respect a better interpretation, a better fulfillment of the Antichrist prophecy than papacy even. So he switched on some points, but he had no very few people listen to what he says because it doesn't fit with the Bible, actually. Papacy, we come back. Luther, the papacy called Luther the Antichrist. So they, when Luther was attacking the papacy pushed it back to Luther again. But of course, everyone was shaking their heads because it wasn't founded on logic or senses at all. It was very stupid, to be honest. Napoleon also won. But the best candidate, except for one here, the best is actually Hitler. Hitler scores enormously on that list. And therefore, I will declare Hitler as Satan's master general test before the last days really will break loose, when all the last persecutions and the superhero Satan is taking on clothes of Jesus and presenting himself as Jesus. At that time, there was a test, there was a generalprøve på engelsk, på norsk, what would that be in English? A general test.
Repetition.
Well, you know what I mean. Yeah, that very big test. If you are in the Norwegian opera, and you have a big opening, and you practice and you practice, and then you have the great practice before. Generalprobe in Norwegian. I believe that Hitler's Third Reich, the Nazi Germany, was a general test, because there Satan showed to his supporters, all his evil angels, he showed, he proved it to them, we can easily deceive a whole country. We can easily, with a stupid man like Adolf Hitler, he looks strange and he behaves strange and he is strange. With that very psychopathic demon of a monster, we can actually mesmerize, hypnotize. We can deceive a whole country. If we can do that with a whole country, we can do it for the whole world.
Don't forget Stalin.
Yes, Stalin was, but he was never as famous as Hitler. But he was just as brutal as Hitler.
Because he was winner.
Yeah.
Nobody speaks about winners.
Yeah, that's right, yeah. That's right. So it is a good point. Stalin and Hitler, they are in the same, they'll sit in the same room in the judgment scene. You know, they'll receive very hard treatments. That's for sure. Very evil people, very evil people. So he was a good candidate. We don't know about the future Pentecostal Antichrist, because he hasn't been revealed. You can only see it in this series, Left Behind, movies and books. But here is the winner. Here is the winner, the papacy. There is no question about it. He is the winner. He is the biblical antichrist that we, as God's people, need to fear and to keep away from and warn other people about. And I'm not here to be popular. You know, because this is not the topic you become popular on in this world. There will be no salary, raising of salary. There will only unpopular and terrible times are ahead of those who will expose this system to the world. And these are the fundamentalists. And this is the way we are going in this world. But God's people will press together, and we will have God's people will be greatly helped by other God's people in the different churches that will come together, and we will say, we will praise God together. And we have two things in common. We believe the Ten Commandments in the Bible, and we believe in Jesus Christ. And we could also add the third one. We believe in the mortality of the soul. We believe that there is no immortality of the soul. I saw now in Vårt Land, the biggest Norwegian newspaper today, you know what they said? They said, NRK is encouraging people to contact the dead. I don't know if any one of you read it. Yeah, this article was an experiment. We must contact the dead people, because now, once for all, we can prove that there is something beyond the grave. Yeah, and it was a big article. And in the beginning it says that NRK has encouraged people to go out and contact the dead. Encourage them. You know, these are new tones. We are living in the last days. There is a masterful deception going on. And the charismatic Catholics and the charismatic evangelicals, they are now coming together in a big melting pot. And it's going to be very interesting to see the unfolding of prophecy in the next few years. So may God bless us and help us. And also those in Lithuania. May God bless all of you pastors and Bible workers. And we will press together. And we will be victorious, because God is on our side. And he has won the victory already. When Jesus went up on the cross, and when they took him down and he broke loose from the grave, you know, from death, the victory is ours. We have the victory through Jesus Christ. Although the rest of the world are dark forces, we have the victory. The victorious one, Jesus Christ, is on our side. So may God help us to understand this and have trust in this. Shall we pray? Dear Father in heaven, thank you so much for your world. Thank you for the book of Revelation. which is a revelation of future events, which is church history written beforehand. Thank you, Lord, for giving us such a book. Forgive us for not paying the attention to this book as it deserves. Help us to be more faithful to study the prophecies. Help us to be more brave to tell our next door neighbor what is the next that will happen in this world. Help us to be loving people so people don't recognize us because of theology, but because of love. This is the most important thing in my prayer now. Help us and guide us, for I pray in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
Okay, there are a few questions. I don't know what time it is, but it's... Is it 9 o'clock?
Yes.
Oh, okay. So then we must wait with the questions to tomorrow. But there was one thing that I just will mention before we leave this place. This is the beast with seven heads in Daniel in Revelation 12. The beast with seven heads in Revelation 13.
Dragon in 12.
The dragon in 12 with seven heads. The beast coming up from the sea with seven heads in chapter 13. And the beast in Revelation 17 with seven heads. There is a difference between these three snapshots of diabolic forces. There is a difference between, because the one in chapter 12, the crowns are on the head. Whereas the one in chapter 13, the crowns are on the 10 horns. And where are the crowns in the one in Revelation 17? There are none crowns there. So what kind of play is being made here? Is there, because every word in Revelation is very weighty and significant. There are no waste of words. There are no words that do not need to be there. Every word in Revelation has to be there, and it is very heavy weight to each word. So when there is a distinction between these three presentations of the beast with seven heads, there must be something behind it. And I want you to think about this when you go home tonight and when you wake up tomorrow morning. And tomorrow you will have the opportunity to reflect on this. You understood my question?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. Why is there a different description of the animal with seven heads in the three places it is mentioned in Revelation? There must be something for us there.
Why he get the deadly wound, the devils, the sea beast?
The sea beast, why he got the deadly wound?
Yeah.
Because
was it from Satan?
Because it was important, because you have a very clear starting point with the decree from Justinian to the Pope and with the clearing of all opposition to papacy in Constantinople and in the Roman Empire at that time. And there was a clear signal from 538, a very great signal that the Pope has started his rule. And likewise, there must be a great signal that he has stopped his rule. And this signal you find when Berthier entered Rome, went into the Vatican, took Pope Pius VI, took him out, humiliated him. He died in another country and an old man, and it was finito for the papacy. And Berthier and his French partners, they made big placards, big posters, hanging them up many places in Roma. And what was the text? The Roman papacy has collapsed, have given in, and in its place has come the Italian Republic. That was the message.
So,
1798, exactly 1260 years afterwards.
Is the God who stopped that?
Yeah, that is a philosophical question.
Okay.
That is, I cannot answer that. But it's a very good and deep question. Very good. I wish we could come together and discuss things like that. So, be blessed, Bjørndalen Church and other visitors. Have a good night.